you like the car?
You could tell.
You want a card? I'm giving them out. They're free.
Yes.
They're just a neighbor.
Thank you very much. How are you? You doing okay? Good to see you. How are you?
Hello, Miss Prue. I'm doing very well.
You're doing good?
I am doing great. Thank you very much. Good to see you.
It's good to see you.
Charlie's here. I haven't seen him with a goatee. Okay, that's who that is. Okay.
Every day, that's why I'm recording.
It's nice to meet you.
You think if I was trying to hide it, I'd be here.
glad you're here. I was hoping you would be capturing this for posterity.
Or I'd send an email to a staff member. Come on.
You gonna come Saturday? Dang right, we'll help him.
He's doing it.
Absolutely, he's well. We'd be mad if you don't come. We'd be mad.
Because I couldn't get you to come with that. I sent it to
him. Would you like your letter?
Commissioner, it's 7 o'clock. Promises, promises, that's all I ever get.
Accessible commissioner on the board. I answer all my emails and answer most of all my phone calls, or most of them. And I've tried to hold these town hall meetings about every 15 months, I suppose it is. So this one was planned about 3 weeks ago. Since then, there's been a lot of things that have changed, I guess. A lot of things have come up. What I want to remind people is this is a county town hall meeting. This is not a campaign stop. So I'm happy to address any questions, but I can't campaign on county time. This is a county building. I didn't pay for it. Personally, I'm using it as a commissioner or an employee of the county. If you, some people here are here that are with other campaigns, I would just ask you to respect that I can't campaign here tonight. And this is not intended to be a campaign stop. It's intended to be a town hall meeting to hear what's on people's minds. With that, I don't really have an agenda. I don't like to have an agenda. I like to know what's on people's minds. I did bring information with me on one issue that we've been working on that was brought up about a month ago, and I'll go ahead and maybe just throw that one out there, was a proposed equestrian park at Lanierland. There seems to be a lot of interest in it, and there seems to be some opposition to it. So I wanted to make that a topic here at this town hall meeting so I could hear what the community has to say and what people believe could be done, should be done, where it would help, where it might harm. So with that, why don't we start with that topic? Everybody's familiar with Lanierland, right? It was purchased with the $100 million Parks and Green Space Bond. It has been master planned to have soccer fields and baseball fields. It was presented to me that we have a lot of soccer fields and a lot of baseball and a lot of other things in the county, but we have never addressed recreation for other people that might like to do other things. And they brought to me an idea to present to our director of park and recreation, maybe have an equestrian facility. I did present that to him. He thought it was a great idea. As a matter of fact, I met with him today. He's very excited about it and believes it does meet the needs of a different constituency. However, if it's not supportable, then of course we'll look at some other options. So, does anybody, I mean, we'll just open it up. Is there questions or comments about it, ideas? Anywhere?
I think it's a necessary item. Every school in this county has an equestrian team. And I don't think anybody realizes how good they are and where they've been. West was number 12 in the nation last year.
That's your Tommy. That's unbelievable.
Central was number three than West Virginia.
Number three in the nation.
Mm-hmm. We have powerhouse teams in this county. It's a huge.
Where do you have your coaches at?
All over the place.
Wherever you find somewhere to
Conyers.
Oh.
Chicopee. We can keep it right here.
Well, I pulled the Wills Park, and they seem to have an event every week. It seems like Wills Park. Does anybody else? Did you, Mr. Ward?
Yeah. Now, I don't live in District 4, but I certainly enjoyed the Nydia when it was operating in the past, and if possible, I would love to see the music being safe.
I have worked to save that since the first concept of this.
You're exactly right. It appeals to a different kind of individual with different entertainment, totally, than the athletic entertainment, but it was a unique thing, different than any other music venue I've ever been to. There was no alcoholic beverage sold there, and I'm sure the Park and Rec would definitely keep that set. So it really brought a family atmosphere. And they, in the past, they were able to get great entertainers, and it had a reputation. The entertainers that were on the road, living in their buses, living in hotels every night, really liked to stop over in Nydia because of a beautiful setting where they could park the buses. So I would definitely support that.
Well, in the music park, what we call the music park, the old venue, the plan is to incorporate that into this equestrian park so that that whole side becomes I don't know if it's going to be used, but certainly if the schools aren't too big now, they can hold graduations there again, or it can be rented for really anything, but it would be incorporated into that. To me, that's a big part of the history of this county. It was important that we try to save that when we acquired that property. Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's great with equestrian for Lanier Park. I think that's great. I think one thing the county, and Wes has done a great job. My husband designed West Forsyth High School. He was the architect of that high school, so we're very proud. But I think that Forsyth County is very much getting away from its roots. People move there for rural nature in the lake, and the equestrian part is part of it. And I live 4 miles from West Forsyth. For 5 years, I've been working with developers to turn my community into an equestrian area with trails. I have horses also, have since I was 8 years old. But I think anything we could do countywide to preserve any kind of equestrian appeal, the county seems to be moving towards, we want to be like the next county, all concrete. And recently, they've shown that in their actions. And I think that we step back and realize what people really want to see for vision of the county. Something like this would be beneficial.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yes,
Pat. So you're saying that the Equestrian Center would still have a music park to be that low?
It would. I've gotten just a couple different, because it's still in a rough concept. I can pass it around, but yeah, the music park itself would become integrated into the equestrian facility. The equestrian facility, when I talked to Jerry Kinsey today, he kind of feels the same way I do. We either need to do it and be the best in North Georgia, or not do it. There's no sense in striving to be mediocre, and that's not what I want. So the thought process, it's going to have RV hookups, it'll have, and again, I'm not an equestrian person, so I don't know all of the nuances of what makes a great facility. What I do want to do, if this is something that's going to move forward, is to get a group of people that are involved in this to be able to meet with our park and rec people and talk about the different things that would be beneficial to make it a good facility or make it the best facility, and then see how it plays out.
At the International Horse Park in Congress, their covered arena is also set up for concerts. So there's nothing wrong with it being multi-purpose. It's just going to bring in more revenue.
And I have to say, my name is Sherry Hamilton. I have a horse farm, and I have quite a few girls here today, and we run barrels, we ride on a national level. I'm very proud of all these girls. I myself hold a benefit every year when we raise money for charity. I had it at my farm a few years. It's grown so big that I actually have to lease a venue, which is located in Rayburn County. They have an arena there, I lease. I would be more than happy to lease space located there where I don't have to travel so far, keep the money in the community. I'm talking hotels, restaurants, gas stations, anything you can think of. I had over 120 riders at my show, and we brought in more money to that community, which we could keep here in the county instead of me taking it to Rayburn County. So that's something that, you know, would benefit us as well, for other people other than myself to bring in groups and riding clubs and rent it.
That's a good point. Yes, sir.
My name's Dick McClure.
Yes, ma'am.
And I've been in the town for 22 years now. We own a 10-acre horse farm. We started building in 86. The subject, I didn't expect the subject of equestrian to come up, but I'd like to tag into it from a different point of view, but I think it's relevant. We put our 10-acre horse farm on the market almost a year ago. We took it off the market not too long ago. And in the course of that year, I mean, it's a tough time to move equestrian properties right now. But they're moving fairly well in North Fulton, Alpharetta, Milton, the eastern edge of Canton, and so forth. Very poorly in this county right now, even lesser in Dawsonville. My point is this: we were on the market for nearly a year. We had six legitimate people come in to view the property. We had some that had no business being there, but we had six that were relevant. None of them made offers, not even silly offers. Feedback from all six spoke to the significant deterioration of the aesthetic qualities of Cumming and Forsyth County. The actual, and these people all went out and looked at what was within a reasonable distance of our property. And they see a parking lot across from the fairgrounds that's been turned into a transportation terminal or whatever. It's terrible looking. They see a produce operation on the corner of the city square that's sitting out there. It looks jumpy. It's got a porta potty right on the curb with no sanitation facilities to relate to it. There is unbelievable trash all over Castleberry Road, from at least Piney Grove into the city, Hutchinson Road, and what have you. And the feedback is, no thank you. I can go places that are much, much more aesthetically attractive, much cleaner, much more beautiful. And I don't want to come to Forsyth County when there are options for me in the nearby counties. Now, I don't know how many of you feel about that, if you've ever had that kind of feedback, but it was loud and strong, and we just simply had to pull out of the market. That's it.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Just wanted to know that about 5 miles from where you guys are planning to do this, there is an equestrian center. 85-acre equestrian center, indoor ring, outdoor ring, that you'll pull a whole lot of business from by sitting down there that's privately owned. Has anybody thought that?
Was it Hillmar?
Yes.
I'll
have to look into that. I didn't know
there was one. Hillmar couldn't handle the events we're talking about. I've done shows at Hillmar. We're talking about.
And also, Hillmar isn't for the community. It's a private bond. It's not a community base. It's not. You can't haul your horse in and just ride on their property. It doesn't benefit the people in the county. That's privately owned. They're making money in their own pocket, not for the taxpayers.
This Will Clark has the barns all around.
I talked to Jerry today about it. The anticipation is that the range will be open pretty much during daylight hours for people to go use as they desire. So yeah, that's
so
true. I don't ever want to put the government in a position to compete or harm private business, and I'll look into that. But you are right that this is no different than, you know, there's baseball academies, but we have baseball teams and they teach it. So we'll look into that. I will appreciate that.
I don't think it'll harm the as a personal business owner. I don't think it's going to harm us. I think the fact that people see that equestrian park, they bring their kids to play tennis, they're like, oh look, there's horses, I want to get involved. That's going to, people are going to be looking for our farms to give their kids lessons.
Right.
They're going
to say,
wow, mom, look at those kids, they're having fun, they're smiling, they're not on the computers, they're not in the mall.
So you're in private business?
Yes, sir.
You don't think this would harm your business?
Absolutely
not.
No.
She's
close to it.
I'm on 400 across from the Hampton subdivision. I'm not trying to promote my business in any way. I'm here for the county. I think that when somebody brings their kids to play tennis or to play, the little girls there watching her brother play soccer, mom, look at those girls. They're on horses. Girls love horses. Those parents are going to say, look at those kids. They're all well behaved. They're all very nicely dressed. They come from, they're good kids. because they're not in the malls, they're not on the computers, they're not doing drugs. These kids are doing things. That's going to bring business to all the individual farms, like Hillmar, like myself, like, I mean, it's going to help us. It's going to bring awareness, and it's going to teach these kids, keep them out of trouble. It's 107 acres, go ride your damn horse, get out of the house, you know? It'll be good.
Nobody around here has seen the kind of shows and money this draws in. Is the things that pull in there blow your mind. Yeah. Unless you've seen the Mercedes-Benz Force trailer, there's nothing like it.
And it's not going to have a boarding facility on there. So it's going to draw people to these businesses because they want to be by that facility.
I mean, they run
you know, how many people want to board their horses to be close to Willis Park?
Absolutely.
You
know?
It's a circuit these people get on. And once you're part of that circuit, it's every year. It continues.
So I'm Jamie Bader. We have a daughter that has been involved in horse. I've been involved in horse most of my life. And she did high school rodeo. And it was a great activity. All three of our daughters did different activities. Keeping them in church, keeping them involved in extracurriculars is huge. No problems with any of them. So we're very proud of that. But we feel like, you look at these young girls here, and at the high schools you've got tennis courts, softball fields, there's swing facilities in the county, tennis courts,
stuff. This is something they can't cross.
Golf course. Right.
Yeah.
And there's a lot more young people that would be involved in these activities if there was a public facility where they could be involved in it. So I think it's key not only to the community but to the young people.
Absolutely.
Anybody else wants to comment on that particular issue?
Well, I'd say something again on in support of that. Our daughter went through horses for, I don't know, 25 years or so from the age of 11. And that's what eventually brought us up here and caused us to build our own place. And so we've been through the Wills Park thing. We've been through the Conyers thing. And you have to get out and drive around to find out exactly how much equestrian activity there is in this county. It's all over the place. You just don't know it's there for the most part.
That's what I've heard for the past 2 years.
And it's tremendous how many people are involved in it. And the serious ones that are trailering to events, I would think getting pretty sick and tired of trying to squeeze into Wills Park or making the long haul over to Conyers with any degree of frequency. And that what's available right now today in terms of people looking for a venue where they can go and ride and compete doesn't exist here. And so I would support the notion that anything related to an equestrian event would be wonderful to think about.
Somebody had emailed me, and I don't know if you're here, about a trail.
That was Brenda Long. It was about cross country. I ride with her as well because I ride English and Western.
Yeah.
It's cross country, and basically it's through the woods, through the fields, and there's obstacles, there's jumps, there's logs, there's things that you jump. So if you made a trail,
how long does this trail have to be?
As long as you want it to be.
Could it be around?
Yeah, absolutely. That's what I was going to say. If you made a trail around the perimeter of this property and made it wide enough where you could either jump or just trot by it or look by it, it would open up to fox hunters, three-day eventers. Those three-day eventers are going to come there. They're going to school their horses on the jump, but they're going to come back and show. It's going to benefit their horses. It's going to benefit the riders. The kids' confidence. That's called cross country.
Cross country.
The kids, the riders' confidence for being over those obstacles already is humongous, and it's just a good benefit.
But it can also be used for trail riding. It is not exclusive to cross country riding.
Right, well, if you
it can
it
be
big
used
enough,
just for pleasure riding
yes.
when
yes,
you have the option.
The county could trail their horses
absolutely.
And ride. The
absolutely, anybody.
Yep.
That's coming. Commissioner Levent is on the dirt bike.
There you go.
Also, last for 7 weeks, then I was a weekend, and last for 3 or 4 weeks, I was 6 pounds.
Just a quick thing to suggest that building this would actually help sales of horse farms in the area. People are going to want to come by the horse farms to be closer to this.
Well, I've heard some of the neighbors would appreciate it because it wouldn't be the lights and the crowds affiliated with organized team sports as well.
I got the glow of Sonny Park for my open downtown.
Yeah.
I'm wondering specifically how this would be funded in terms of the maintenance upkeep. I'm assuming there's some sort of, would there be staffing of this? So where do those funds come from?
Before I'll commit to it anyway, we have funding through the Green Space Fund to construct it. Mm-hmm. It would then have to be a self-funding property. I don't know enough yet to tell you if that's the case or not. We are gathering information from Wills Park and from Chicopee, and we'll get with Conyers now that I know about that and get that information. But we're hoping that it would be at least a break even, or if not a profit.
Okay, so by self-funding you mean if this couldn't pay for itself and it would actually create pressure on maybe raising millage rates, then we probably wouldn't do this, right?
Right.
Okay.
I have a question. Who pays for all the soccer fields maintaining on exit?
Well, you're exactly right. That you're exactly right.
We all
these kids are kids of the county as well as the kids
you're
that
exactly
play over
right.
there.
And if it comes out, I would not, at this point with the economy, vote to raise the millage rate to open a park of any nature. None whatsoever. Whether it's soccer, pool, horses, I don't care what it is.
Good
I'm not
answer.
Going to do anything that's going to raise the millage rate. If indeed that it turns that we can shave money from existing recreation programs or from other areas, you know, I would consider that. But I really believe it would be the term is revenue neutral is what I keep hearing. I just don't have those facts yet. So, but that's the intent.
Yes, for ma'am. Just for your research purposes, there's a new equestrian, relatively new equestrian center opened in Jacksonville, Florida, somewhat like what you're proposing, except it doesn't have the other sports. You might be able to find out more from them about how their costs.
I'm from Jacksonville originally.
Jacksonville, Florida. There you go.
Years, but yeah, I'll call
yeah.
them down there.
Because you know where Green Coast Springs is, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
There's a huge facility in Clay County where they have a show fixing to start this weekend.
Yes.
I don't know if you're aware, but we already have problems within the recreation department with the softball, baseball, with lighting. We cannot get practices when it's dark. I mean, and that is year round, and that's been for the last 2 years. They can't turn on the lights because they say they don't have the money. So I don't know where we can shave. You've mentioned shaving.
That was a potential.
We can't pay for the lights right now for the kids to play ball.
It may
ball.
Not. I'm just saying that would be a potential. It
yeah.
might be in some other area as well. But yes, you're right.
I mean, that is a problem. We have, and we're short on field space if we have to play while it's light, if they're not letting us use the lights.
Right. Any other questions on that topic?
Shut some fields down. I mean, they got no fields.
But in response to what this lady said, isn't it going to be a money generating venue anyway? For
that's what I'm hearing.
And people that come
absolutely.
To sell their wares.
That's what I'm hearing. I can't say yes or no, but more people than not are telling me that it is going to be a profit generator, which would then subsidize some of the other park and rec programs.
Will Spark makes money for Alfred.
Yes.
But I don't think you'll find that the case in Jacksonville where that facility is a multi-million dollar facility built that they're talking about closing.
Where is it?
It's out White House Way, Chafee Road,
Chafee Road.
Near the old
Chafee
U.S. Navy.
Is it owned by the
Naval.
City or
the The city opened it.
City opened it.
Yeah. Okay. You missed spent lots of taxpayer dollars and it's not
right.
doing well.
Yes.
No.
They might have closed it already. Yeah, it's good to know.
Anybody else on that topic?
Well, I feel like we are an equestrian county. I mean, anywhere you go up Johns Creek, you got the paddocks, you got this, you got that, and there's so many horse farms and there's so many horse owners around here. There's just no way that it wouldn't succeed. There's just no way. We need it too badly.
And you think about all the revenue that Dawson Forest brings in every year, but every time you go, it's $10 to ride. You think of how many people go in a day and how much revenue they bring in, that can all be staying in this county. I know I go up there and ride in the summertime once a week training horses.
We also have within the last year, I suppose it's been that the Chamber of Commerce has hired someone at markets recreation to bring in the baseball and softball tournaments, the little major league and all that kind of stuff. We're going to meet with her next week and see if she has anything to add to it, because that's her background, marketing, sports, and recreational venues. So you can be rest assured that we studied well, and I agree with you. And also bring in people, as you said, that be spending money in our stores. They'll be staying in our hotels. They'll be eating in the restaurants.
Buying from the beauty stores.
No, I'm saying,
And then from the other side of it, when very similar to perhaps baseball, a friend of mine has a private hitter's park where people go learn pitching and hitting and all that. So it might benefit some of these private businesses. The more people that are playing, people do want to spend a little more money and practice a little more, get a little more training, so they may benefit those. I'm not sure, but it makes sense.
And Patrick, too, is the facilities from the music park. That might be a good draw for people like, you know, the Monty Roberts of the world, you know, fans to come and put on. Trainers who come now to Centennial Park, not Centennial Park, down to Conyers to put on big shows, clinics.
The clinics are huge.
Yeah.
So there's other, again, this is stuff, and that's why if this paper
things.
Anybody that emailed me, I'll be emailing back out again, because the reality is I don't know anything about equestrian facilities. I don't know what teams do. I don't know. But we'll need people to advise and help give us ideas on what to do.
Do you need somebody to go with you to speak to a marketing person?
If you'd like to go.
No,
I'd be glad. I mean, I believe that she would be supportive of this kind of an idea, because it's what she does, and it's what we believe for Forsyth County. You know, we have not, we've got the greatest park and rec system probably in the state of Georgia. And one of the reasons she was brought on board was to capitalize on that, Fowler Park, to have these major events come in, very similar to the little go-kart track down there. You talk about what people spend on these things. I mean, you go down there, you've got 11-year-old boys. They got $250,000 rig sitting down there.
This would set Forsyth County apart. We wouldn't be Blant County little brother.
Right.
You know, we'd be on the map more than just having the lake.
When we did high school rodeo, we traveled extensively around Georgia, and they were held in private and public facilities. And some of them were located in pretty remote areas, but in talking to the management and the staff, they all were, I'm sure, neutral, if not profit-making. And the one in Raven County was just open last year, and it is a nice facility. So there's got to be some incentive for them to be opening a farm or a facility like that.
Local farms. That have significant riding arenas, many of them enclosed and capable of hosting an audience, so to speak. Some of these facilities attract world-class trainers and world-class instructors, but they're limited in capacity to how many people they can entertain or what have you. Maybe, you know, maximum 20, 30 at a time, because they're private farms. They're not built for crowds. Yet, Forsyth County is in the mindset of a lot of equestrian people outside of this county, outside of this state, that are familiar with the number of barns that are available and the amount of activity there is, which would further enhance what's being said in terms of all of a sudden somebody's got knowledge at the right place of a facility being developed in Forsyth County. That would go a long way. The other thing is, I think Forsyth County gets a significant amount of people relocated from other parts of the country into Forsyth County. And one of the bummers, so to speak, is that equestrian facilities that we're speaking about are not here. Yet so many of the people are coming into this county as opposed to North Fulton or what have you. Another reason. Yeah, and these people that are coming in typically have the finances to
contribute to the stipend thing. Right. So it's a great subject.
Yes, ma'am.
If an equestrian park has the potential to generate all of this revenue that you all are talking about, then why hasn't someone done this as a private enterprise?
I couldn't tell you.
Just
when you haven't had population 20 years ago, there were 40,000 people in chicken houses.
It hit it, done that.
It's changed. And it's changed fast.
To that,
well, I'd like to
that
say
question.
Something about that. Not that my income is any of everybody's business, but I held shows at my bond last year. I had probably eight. I raised over $17,000. Okay, their money is there. You just have to build it. I'm not going to say build it, they'll come. But if it's run properly, and you can uphold good, you know, you have, like this gentleman said, you don't have people drinking. You know, it's a good family environment. At the national level, that rewrite on with the NVHA, it's, you know, you go to horse shows, there's people with trailers that you would think that these people had motorhomes. I mean, these trailers just have water beds and central heat and air conditioning and hardwood floors, and people have things, and it's just a family environment. And when people get used to doing that, they're gonna want it more and more and more. It's gonna become bigger and bigger. And yes, the first year, probably not gonna make as much money as we're gonna make 10 years down the road. But it will, once you're established, it will happen. Mm-hmm. You just have to get the word out there and get the people involved in it and get these little kids coming. The kids, the children of the county is what's important, is what's gonna build this. You know, the kids sitting at this table, they're gonna be graduating high school in 2 years, going off to college, probably not gonna affect them, but it's their little brothers and sisters. It's your neighbor's little kid. It's the little kids in the elementary schools right now. That's who it's gonna benefit.
We're there.
The county and the nearby counties have a significant number of golf courses. Many, many of them, if not most of them, were private with subdivisions and what have you. And well over 50% of them have now gone public, making themselves available to just about anybody, at least on a social membership, as opposed to maybe a complete package with golf. And they're doing reasonably well now that they've attracted more people through the public membership. Because the overbuilding of the golf course is significantly impacted by the economy. A lot of people can't afford what they used to be able to afford. Yet, there's so many of them that the economy is not right, and it's not going to be right for a long time to support them all. One equestrian facility is a whole different thing. And probably to everybody else's point of view, easy to support. You gotta get your feet wet, though.
Take somebody. Yes, ma'am.
I wanted to say that. I'm sorry.
It's okay. Sorry. I'll over anyway.
This is our little IEA coach. This is our part of our little team. We have like five little girls that we put together because we had to go on the budget plan. So we have our used boots, our secondhand helmets, our secondhand things, because we are trying to go to these shows and they are so expensive because we have to go Alpharetta, Chicopee Woods, Chateau Alon. So we've got our little, you know, secondhand kids, but they all ride really well. So we tried to sign up for a show this weekend in Alpharetta, and there's over 400 entries for Saturday and Sunday at $35 a pop. That doesn't include the trainer fees that they're getting, the trailer fees these people are getting, the food
the
they're selling.
Fees.
I mean, it's an unbelievable no-brainer. It is, and these kids need that. They need that. We have no place to go.
What I was just going to say is not about my great kids, but that when you build this, I think part of what went wrong in Jacksonville was they jumped deep into a fantastic facility. And as I said to you earlier when I was looking at the map up there, you don't build everything you think you're going to need, but you've got to leave space to expand because it will expand. But you'll cut your own throat if you build it all first thing. And then everybody will be unhappy.
That's my point,
exactly. Okay. Do you have a cost estimate? Have they given you a...
No, the gentleman Reggie doing in... planner has been sick for 2 weeks, so he's not gotten that to us.
You better buy a horse.
Did you have a question?
You better get a horse.
Yes, ma'am, you had your hand.
I think she asked a question.
Is there a time frame?
It was so lucrative. Why
instead of, and why would they want the county to do it and the taxpayers to do it rather than the private enterprise?
To me, I look at it, you know, there's a big debate, I guess, that goes on constantly about what is the role of government?
Yes.
And does government, are we supposed to be in the recreation business?
Yes.
Okay. The federal government was never designed to be in the recreation business. Local government, what our job is, my job is to listen to the constituents. And if they want baseball diamonds, we build baseball diamonds. If they're willing to pay for it, we're going to build it. Our job is to provide services to our citizens.
We all have to pay for it. We all have to pay for the services.
We do, because we're a community.
Yes.
But the notion that local government is the same as the federal government is incorrect. Frankly, it's incorrect.
But it's almost trying to be, isn't it?
No, ma'am.
No.
I believe that our job at the local level, you know, I didn't vote for the $100 million Parks and Green Space Fund. I didn't want the county to go in debt to the tune of $100 million for parks. Okay? I have no problem saying I didn't vote for it. I did not support it. But 85% of our taxpayers did. So my job is now to use those resources to the best of my ability and be able to provide something for all of our citizens, not just soccer and football people, not just baseball and softball people, not aquatic people, all the people. We have tennis courts. We have all kinds of stuff for people. We have rec centers. We have skateboard parks. I mean, we got all kinds of things that our citizens have asked us to do with that money. So, you know, my job now is to listen to what people are asking for. And then how do we do it in a fiscally responsible method? This is a method that will potentially generate income that will help offset some of these other things. Now, why is a private business not doing it?
Why free enterprise hasn't generated that?
I don't know the answer to that.
I do. I just told you I agree.
Here's the difference.
Okay, I do. I started last year with these horse shows. Okay, mine's very small scale. The one I had in Rayburn County, when I say what I just made here with these other 8 shows, I'm talking 12 to 15 kids on one day a month. So I do it. I do it on a small scale because I have other, I'm not just a horse show lady. I have
a
son.
So you want the county to enlarge it?
No. I'm not going to use the county. No. That's a mistake. I think we're off. Okay. My business is my business. The county part is for the children. I'm not going to make any money. I give lessons at my place. That's where I'm getting my income.
She's gonna go there.
I'm
going to
take
money.
These kids there so they can school their horses in different venues, make them better riders, keep them out of trouble, give them a different place. I'm not going to make money off the county. The county's going to make money off me when I bring my kids there and I got to pay a grounds fee.
Okay.
The county's going to make money when I rent that arena instead of going to Rayburn County, giving them $500 a day. I'm going to give it to this county. Plus, all the people that come to my show is going to give the county money. As a businesswoman, I'm not asking the county to make money for me. I'm going to use them so I can make money and they can make money off me. It's not that we don't. This is a county thing. I'm not asking them to build that to benefit me, the kids, and then I'll put the money, my kids will be generating money for them.
So you're just equating it with the ball fields and that sort of thing.
That's the way I equate
pretty
it.
Much.
It's just another service.
It's just, yeah, I mean, people, they have soccer teams that go use
yeah,
the soccer
they have to
field.
Play
this
to
is
pay
a team. This is a riding
have
team.
To pay to ride our horses. I'm not looking for a free ride. I want
absolutely
a, I want
not.
A place to go.
Well,
and, you know, they just took 100 acres, bought 100 acres of Bursanoia Farm, which I was very sad to see all that space go. And they just put the fence lines up, and they spent all the money on the shade trees, and they're going to put all this stuff in there, and it's very sad. That's 100 acres of trails that just went out the window. We're not allowed to ride on it.
And I would have more shows, but like I said, we compete on a national level, so we don't have but one weekend a month that we're available to have shows at my farm on a small scale. So that's that's what I
do. I was just trying to.
No, and I'm trying to understand, absolutely. I don't take it personally at all.
You got to keep in mind, there are some tremendous facilities that are private, but they can't do a huge show. The shows we're talking about here, 300, 400, 500, 600 horses coming in. It's not 20.
You have to have
these are major events.
Area.
Major.
Something else to keep in mind is the variety of disciplines. No one's mentioned it yet. There are within Western riding, there are many disciplines. Within English riding, there are many, many. I mean, you could sit here and name them all forever. But each one of those discipline will have, does have, its own show. So each one is another event for that venue.
I have to tell you, I laugh at that. I'm only 10 minutes.
I've
just got a
problem
with brakes. I'm all good.
They may not have a break.
Send them to me. I'll train them up with the brakes right on.
Any other questions on that topic or comments?
Will horses be boarded at this facility?
No.
No, only
okay, so it'll be a facility to keep them already have horses.
Oh, yeah.
Just at the show.
Just during the show.
You couldn't bring a group of kids.
You got a 3-day show. Are you going to have stalls there?
Absolutely.
You have the horses. You have to.
But you just couldn't come in and ride a horse.
For instance, Wells Park has 300 stalls.
Yeah, the county's not going to have horses that we're going to provide for people to ride.
Okay, so it'll be a facility just for people who already have horses.
Unless
they want
to get in there and
kind of watch. Just have one thing, and at Wills Park they have other events besides the equestrian. They also do like dog shows, agility. They have some rescue events and things. So it's something else. Yeah, there's other things, and like someone else mentioned, clinics.
We've been trying to help Lance with the mud strike, and he wanted to have it fall apart.
Mm-hmm.
We're trying to get that to happen.
Yeah.
But, you know, this kind of facility could host that as well.
Right. Many other things could be hosted there related to animals.
Exactly.
I think it'd be really positive.
Anything else on horses?
How many ball fields would be included?
Well, there's 1, 2, 3, 4. There's 5 baseball, softball fields, and there'll be 2 rectangle fields out there as well. There'll also be trails. There's a area that there's an old cabin back, and I'll be happy to pass this around. If I don't know, I didn't know this many people would be here. I'd have had a big one up for everybody, but it'll have a lot of facilities.
You can look at that online.
Yeah, it is on the county website. And if you can't find it, email me, and I'll send it to you. Anything else on equestrian, parks, rec?
Yes. One quick comment.
Yeah.
Clark Howard on Channel 2 reported tonight that the true figures of Georgia's unemployment is 22%. Here we are talking about throwing money. We better be worried about the depression that's coming on top of us like a jet airplane.
Well, I like old Clark Howard, but I have to use state numbers in the Census Bureau, and right now we're at 8.2, but I agree with you.
They were absolutely wrong. Mm-hmm. The true figure was 22%. That was just a couple hours ago or so.
However, this will also provide employment, long-term and short-term, in the building
office. Any other questions on that? All right, what other topics are that people like to talk about? We got all kinds of great things.
Can I bring up my favorite topic?
Land use.
Here I am. Land use. Okay, we've been talking horses, right, people? For you who sit over there, what was your name, Mr. McClure?
McClure.
Okay. My name's Joanne Leach. I live in a little community called Ducktown. Went through a comprehensive land plan, and not many people probably in this room was even aware of it. It was a year-long event, countywide. This was everyone's chance in the entire county to say, this is how we want our community vision, our land to be planned through 2032. Very few people showed up at the meetings. People didn't care. On my road alone, which is called Howard Road, there were 2 different groups. There were the land investors. They want the complete destruction of our community. They want both agriculture to high density and commercial. There's my group, which is a huge, 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 huge majority, massive majority. So we fought for a year. We met with Fishers, we met with the Planning Commission, we met with the Board of Commissioners, the Steering Committee, everybody involved, 21 decision makers. Well, it was decided since there was 2 groups in my area, to make it fair, there would be a vote. Do we keep it as a state residential for all the horsey people involved? What the state residential is, it allows for 2 homes per acre. It allows us to keep some equestrian nature in Forsyth County. So that's what my group represents. We're not against development. I've been in home building for a long time, not any longer. I'm an auctioneer. But if we're for state residential, trying to keep some of the integrity of Forsyth County intact. People move here for the rural nature. They move, people stop in front of my house every week. We have people stopping every week. Is your home for sale? I keep my house immaculate, my whole property is. But anyway, we went through your own process and we voted. So we had four maps. Three were kind of the same. Four was the destruction of our county. There were 268 votes countywide, so this could be this district. I'm in District 3. 268 votes the cast to say, okay, we want to keep our county. We want development to move in. We want people to be allowed to come in, but we want to keep some of that rural nature. We want what's a state residential on that map. 268 people voted. 151 of those people were in my group. Map number four, which was the destruction of the county, got the least amount of votes. So we voted, we won. The Board of Commissioners came in and said, you cannot have it. We're gonna take away your votes, throw them out the door, and now we're gonna go for the destruction of the county. Folks, right now, as we stand, we're going towards an approval of this map in June of this year. It'll be in place for until 2032. There is no estate residential left except for two little dots on the map. It will look worse in the Gwinnett County. And for all you people that are saying, well, we want the equestrian nature, we want our county to look better, you better hold on tight, because if you think the economy's bad, you should wait and see what this county is coming to. I ask Commissioner Bell, I ask in front of the Board of Commissioners, I'll ask again, why did the Board of Commissioners vote against the majority of the county? Why did we vote for the destruction of the county? Yes, we want development. I mean, I'm not a tree hugger, but I'm fine with development. But you know what? My group fought for 1 year. I have one lady in my group. She's 73 years old now. Just gave her a box of Russell Stover's last week for her birthday. 73 years old, she was born in the freaking house she lives in my road. She worked side by side with me, going to houses, explaining to people, this is what, do you agree with us? Do you not agree with us? Yes, we presented our facts, and we wanted our area to look like Milton, you know, something similar to that. Because everybody thinks, well, why does our county look so bad? This is the exact reason. Yes, you can't tell people what to do about their property rights and what they should do with their property, but you know what? My group has rights also, and my group wanted to look at the community vision, the county division. We don't want to tell people what to do, but we want to say, okay, you know what? Let's keep some integrity. When all the people move out and they're long ago, I want my area, my community, which is the Howard Road community, to have some integrity. People can ride down and have horse farms. We can have new developments. We can have 2 houses per acre. But you know what? Let it blend in. Let my old house that was built in, you know, the early part of the century, let it blend in with some dignity, integrity, and let's keep some of that character that with the what the Board of Commissioners voted for is really going out the door. It's a shame.
Okay. You want me to address that?
Please, yes, yes.
Thank you.
The Board of Commissioners got a map. The Planning Commission actually forwarded this version forward to us. So when the Board of Commissioners did, that's what they forwarded as their recommendation. I told you, I've met with you how many times? Half dozen times, probably?
I've met with people. I've met with people.
Our staff has indicated that there was never this deal about voting, because that's not the way it works. I don't know if it was made or not. I'm telling you, they say it wasn't.
Yeah.
When you talk about the majority of the people, mm-hmm. you and I talked about that. You had the majority of the people.
Yes.
They had the majority of the land.
No.
Acreage, they did.
No, they did not.
Well, that's what was given to me by our planning staff.
We can tell they did not investigate it like I asked you to. Yeah. They did not have
the majority. They presented at the last public hearing.
Yeah.
That you had some, 4, 5, 6, 8-year-old petitions for people to
do that? No. The petition they presented had been in place for a year.
No.
That's not true. That's not, the one lady got up, the very disgruntled lady got up, the one that is a little bit disillusional, but she got up and she said, we found 10 signatures are not validated. That petition I presented is right here in my brochure. I've got it right here.
I understand it's not, but what I'm telling you is,
it was one. It was 1 year. It was 1 year old.
And some of those people don't live there, or they're dead.
No, not exactly.
The other thing is, let me finish, because you asked me a question. I let you give your whole entire spiel.
Okay.
The final thing is, I'm a property rights advocate.
Yeah.
And what you want me to do is put a restriction on somebody else's property so that you can enjoy something.
No.
And I don't subscribe to that belief. I just don't.
Well, can I answer the petition? There were 10 invalid. 4 had lost to foreclosures. And the road captain that got there were 4 on there that was wrong. That's exactly right. But the other group had 26 households. We had 116. So it was never presented to us, well, if they have 1 more acre of land than you do, it's going to make all that difference. However, it was presented to us by the lady who is a high-paid employee by the county, Vanessa Bernstein.
Ms. Bernstein didn't make decisions. The Planning Commission does.
Exactly. And how it was presented to us.
I don't know why she told you that. She says that she didn't.
Well, she did. And I've got it in an email right here. So anyway, how she presented it to us is that the votes will decide the fate. Otherwise, why would we work so hard to do it and suddenly believe it? So we had, presented with 29 votes. We presented with 151 votes. We have more households. If there's a difference of 1 acre, we say, just like when somebody votes for you, you ask for votes, you don't come back and say, you know what? I'm sorry, you know, I'm not going to win. I got 75% of the vote, but some people own more land over there, and they're going to. You can't do that.
But this is not.
This was a voting process.
Well,
it was set up like that.
I disagree with you. I'm sorry, but I do. And my personal belief is I would vote to put restrictions on somebody else's land because somebody else doesn't want to look at a house or whatever. I'm not going to.
Well,
now I insist that you be good neighbors. I would never allow a Walmart to go on Howard Road.
Well, this is my viewpoint. We're not against development, but to go from agriculture.
But you're against allowing those people to have the density that they can sell their property.
So you would agree that so everyone in this room, listen, you agree that you would allow to go from agriculture to rest for a tax, right?
No, I didn't say that.
That's what they're doing.
That's one of the uses within suburban living.
And it's commercial.
But that doesn't mean that that's what's going to go there, nor does it mean what the Board of Commissioners will allow.
What would you think, just for everybody in the room, say if you have agriculture, what would you say would be a good move up from agriculture? Well, what would you just...
That is irrelevant right now. What we're talking about is they own hundreds of acres, and they have the right to do what they want with their property.
But shouldn't we have proper planning to make the county look good so other people will want to come in?
We are a suburban community outside Metro Atlanta of 5 million people. You know, I'm not. If you think that I would allow detached housing or apartments that's 6 to the acre, you'd be wrong.
Yeah.
If you think I'd allow major retail to go in there, you would be wrong. Just because it's allowed doesn't mean that's what's going to be permitted.
Right.
Okay, so.
Well, we were wrong in paying our votes.
The reality is, and I have no bones about it, I will not vote to restrict other people's property because somebody else doesn't want to look at something. I had somebody tell me one time, we get up every morning and we sit here and we look at the ducks in that pretty pond. Well, it's not your pond, and they're not your ducks. And I will not vote to restrict other people's property.
What we're for is responsible growth.
Responsible
development.
I am too.
What y'all have approved is the destruction of my community. And we feel very strongly about what's been done. We feel very violated. And I'm very upset about this. And, you know, if we would have lost, then I've told my members, we'll walk away from it. Congratulations to the other group, but we won. And here again, it's not about hurting them. They've already had their chances to sell their properties. They refuse, and now we keep paying the price. And all we're asking for is, let's remember that people do move here. for the lake and rural nature, and what the Board of Commissioners has approved is the destruction of the rural nature of Forsyth County, and that should be a problem for everyone in the county. Thank you.
Any other questions? Any other topics? Yes.
Yeah. I'm Don Tackett. I live here in District 4. I lived here for 14 years. I just have a question about something that came up in the paper about 3 weeks ago, maybe. It was called the Association of County Commissioners that want to change the rules for splots using 15% of the splots money for operating expenses, operating costs. I'd like to know what your opinion is about that, and if I guess Commissioner Boff is now the chairman. What is he going to do, or what is his thoughts, or do you know his thoughts? I can't speak. I don't know. What's your thoughts about doing that? Just that.
I've not studied it enough yet. I generally don't support it. I'll tell you that my first notion is not to support it. SPLOST was originally designed to give relief to taxpayers and property owners to build capital projects, things that we needed. It's really designed for roads, bridges, sidewalks, courthouses, and jails. It was not really, I don't ever believe, originally intended for soccer fields and rec centers and all that. It's done, nothing I can do about it. But generally, I'm not supportive of it, but I will tell you, I don't know all the facts yet. Okay. I think one of the big problems that we've had around here is we've had a Board of Commissioners that goes out and sells all these projects and how great it's going to be. Pass this thing. And then we forget we got to pay for it on the back end. Yep. And I think they've done a very poor job of letting people know about that. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah, recently I read that it's either coming before a work session, or maybe you still have it to come up, but some change to the UDC in regard to tree ordinance or tree removal of homes in suburbs.
Limited timber.
Pardon me?
Limited timber. And it's basically an approval for people that have tracts of land that are zoned residential, but that they're not moving forward because of the economy. That with the oversight of our county arborist, they can go in and do limited timbering, which means they can maintain the property, sell some timber, generate some money to pay their taxes. The county also, I didn't know this, got timber tax, but it's basically, it's very limited. It's not clear cutting, there has to be a buffer, it's a 50-foot buffer that they can't touch. So that's all it is, limited. And it really needs to be in the footprint of the proposed roadways and things of that nature, too.
Is there a land size that this is
10 limited? Acre minimum. Did that answer everything on that?
Yeah.
Anything else?
We don't want a horse tax.
No horse tax. I'll tell you something else I'm going to get rid of, is the fee to accept your money. When you come pay your business license, you got to pay a $25 fee so we take your money. Yeah, that's not the silliest thing. Any other questions? Any other topic?
I've got another one.
Yes.
I'm back to where I started. What do the commissioners and the commission and the county versus the city of Cumming and its limited boundaries, okay? What's the position on beautification? I know there's a beautification committee out there and all that.
But I'm talking about the county.
Either one or all of the above. My point is this. It's a filthy area at this point in time. There's trash everywhere. Mm-hmm. Nothing's being done about it. What's going to be done about it?
As far as the city goes, you have to go talk to the mayor, council, and city residents.
That's the city. I can do that.
As far as the county goes, I think we've got some areas of the county that do have some older type structures.
I'm not talking structure. I'm talking trash.
You get to work
good.
I
Would you send me an email just reminding me that?
I know that I'm getting bombarded with this question, so I'm sure that you are all the time as well. With the three big decisions y'all got coming up that are major decisions that will affect us possibly for decades to come, the water agreement with the city, the lost division, and then the
service
delivery. What's your position on those?
As far as water goes, I am striving to get a long-term contract, depending on the rates that we can get. We lost a huge economic development opportunity long before I came along, and I can't remember the name of it. Supervision or something, maybe? But they didn't come because they didn't feel comfortable that we had a long-term water supply, and I think that their process used a lot of water. I believe that the fact of the matter is the county does not have a long-term water supply solution today. Will we have one? Perhaps. Today we don't. And anything that we do is going to take 20 years to get done anyway. We need a 25-year, a minimum 25-year water contract with reasonable rates. I don't know what the rates are yet. That's being negotiated.
What about finished water rates with our facility being able to?
We can treat a lot of finished water.
Are you looking at a long-term contract for finished water rates?
Long-term for raw and short-term with renewals for finished. Now, is the city going to accept that? Your guess is as good as mine. But the mayor has offered in some scenarios, and I don't have all of them right here in my head, to roll back the finished water price back to when this current agreement started. But that's if we sign a little bit longer finished water contract. I've been advocating for a tapered water contract, which means right now we have to buy 1.6 billion gallons a year in the city, that tapers down over time, and the more that we can ramp up our processing. You know, we don't know if we can finish it any cheaper or not. We know that the net cost of finished water is 60 to 62 cents, but that doesn't include the cost of infrastructure and all those other things, depreciation on the equipment that has to be replaced over time. So we don't know that. But the fact is, we do not have a long-term water solution. So we need that to get that in place. If we're going to maintain economic development opportunities, maintain the value of the land, things of that. Because if the word gets out that Forsyth County has no water, the fastest growing county in the nation has no water, your property is worthless because nobody's going to buy it. As far as lost and service delivery strategy, I've seen a lot of conversations about it where people are talking about the split. But what we have to take into account is several things. There's eight factors that we have to look at. But we also have to look at the value of the property within the city versus the entire county. We have to look at the budget of the county versus the city. We have to take into account the services provided. So the service delivery strategy and loss, it's really a hand-in-hand type of a negotiation. And the more services they're willing to provide that we don't have to pay for, of course, the bigger split they would get. The more they don't want to provide, the less they would get. Do I know what the right number is today? No. Population split, I've heard people say, well, it's got to be based on population. That's completely wrong. Population really doesn't have much to do with it. If population did have something to do with it, it might hurt us because we have to consider, in that case, you have to go to the Census Bureau and look at daytime population as well. When you look at the county is virtually empty, and the city's full. So, you know, it goes both ways. It might harm us to try to go with that scenario. It's supposed to be addressed Thursday night. I don't think it will be. I don't think we have all of our information together yet. Hopefully we'll start talking about water on Thursday night. And we've got until the end of the year to work with Austin Service Delivery, with July 1st being the time that we have to start negotiations. So it's going to be a difficult task.
The water's March.
Water's May 26th. And the question about is the mayor going to turn off the water? No, I don't think the mayor can turn off the water. What the mayor can do is say, it's $10 a thousand where you were paying 10 cents a thousand before. Now, Fort Grave is not going to do that. He might threaten it, but he's not going to do that. You know, everybody hates the mayor, but the fact of the matter is, he loves the county just as much as he loves the city. But his obligation in negotiations, his fiduciary responsibility is to the city. But he loves the county. He's got family that lives in the county. So, you know, but he's going to drive a hard bargain. There's no doubt about it. He always does. And we will negotiate as hard as we can to make sure we get the best deal for the citizens of the county.
I thought we were just this close to getting our own intake.
Well, I know a guy one time told me that we were this close.
Just this close.
Just this close. That's gone. History. So, we are close to getting a permit to discharge into the Chattahoochee. If we can somehow convince the riverkeeper to quit appealing all the decisions. So far, we've spent nearly $700,000 of taxpayer money fighting an environmental activist that doesn't want us to dump water into the river that's cleaner than the water that's in the river. Because she's worried about the trout that we put in there that aren't even natural. So, that didn't go on a while.
I put up a lot of fencing at that horse pond. Damn the fish, we're going to eat them anyway. I'm just kidding. I like fish, I'm just kidding.
How do you feel about that riverkeeper?
Any other topics of questions?
Yeah, I guess this one right here, Commissioner Bell, you sent four legal threat letters to four people in this room
threatened to
sue us because you didn't want us attacking your family, is what it says in here. We've done research between the four people in this room, and we cannot find any instances of where where anybody has attacked any member of your family. Now, we have put documented evidence on that where we suppose that you've got a sweetheart deal from the United Community Bank, and we have the documented evidence here.
There's no evidence there, Mr. Mound.
Yeah, and it's documented.
You know what interest rate I'm paying?
As you said before, if you were supposedly hiding it, you wouldn't have filed it.
It's all out there.
That's fine. We're not arguing that whatsoever. The documented evidence is good enough for us.
That's absolutely.
Do you have any statement to make in front of these folks about
sure.
the
Which
validity?
One do we start with?
This
Which
is one? Your this is your transfer of your private home.
To my dad?
To your dad into a corporation, and then you still, I assume you still live in the house?
Of course, it's my house.
It is your house?
Yes, it's my house.
Okay, but it's in a corporation's name.
It is.
And you own the corporation?
I'm a shareholder in the corporation. My dad's the other shareholder. We put it in there for estate planning purposes. My dad's wife died. I'm single.
Okay.
My kids, I'll put it in an LLC so that all of those assets
so all transferred. This all this transfer took place during the time that you were voting and discussing moving the county's money to the United Community Bank. Is that correct?
That would be wrong.
Am I wrong about that?
You're wrong.
Oh, I am?
Because I recused myself from the voting. As soon as this started, I went to our county attorney and told him what was going on. He advised that I recuse myself. Mr. Milo, it takes three people to pass something.
Right.
Not one, three.
Right.
I pay a higher interest rate than the street rate.
So none of us should have any problem with this transfer of your home and with Community Bank. This is totally legit, clean.
Absolutely.
FDIC will have a problem.
If I had a thing to hide, I would not have had it filed locally.
Thank you, sir.
The letter's right there from my attorney.
Yes.
Sent to you. I think Ms. Mills got one.
Yeah.
Who else got one? Ms. Story got one.
Yes. And Ms. Tisdale.
Yeah, Ms. Tisdale. I'm a public official. I'm elected to serve the people of this county, and I'm glad to do so.
Okay.
But when people start dragging my son and things of that into it, yeah, I'm going
to. And one of us did that?
Yes, sir. I've got the screen captures. I've got this all of it.
Would you like to
I would not
folks,
have sent that.
Did I do that?
It was on your site. You were sent this because you were the administrator
on
of
my
site. A blog.
That you don't argue.
I'm not going to argue with him because he's wrong.
Did Ms. Mills, did she attack your son?
Mr. Milo, I will just tell you, okay, because you're sitting here, you're grandstanding.
No. I want to clarify in my own.
If you talk about my son, my daughter, my ex-wife is a very good friend of mine.
Yeah.
My dad, yeah, I'm going to sue you, okay?
Well,
I'm
going to
sue.
That's
now, if you
well, take it to court and leave it out of this room.
Exactly.
Really?
This is a community event.
Yes.
Sit down. You have a question about what I just told you. You come on public decision I've made. I'm as transparent and open as accessible as any person in this state, Mr. Miley.
You answered my question.
You've never called to verify anything that you've logged.
Who paid off your mortgage?
Yeah.
Who paid off your mortgage?
I pay it every month.
Who paid off the mortgage for the transfer?
There is none. The LLC has a mortgage on it. Thank you very much, which I pay every month.
You know what that is.
Why are you so worried about my estate planning, Terry?
Just ask a question.
What, I understand, but why are you so worried about my estate planning, Terry?
Because when you do banking in the county and there's some sneaky stuff going on,
there's no
I'd like
sneaky
to ask
stuff.
A question. You know
there's
what
no
mean?
Sneaky stuff.
Yeah.
It's all documented on the clerk's office. That's the reason it's there. It's because it's transparent.
And that methodology is very common for estate planning.
Yes. It absolutely is.
If you don't I'm know about the estate planning, don't ask the
problem. Nobody can bother your kids.
Thank you.
Yes. They're not a public official. You are.
You're absolutely right.
Let's change subjects.
Go ahead.
Hi, Randy.
All right, what is the county's position relative to electioneering signs on property all throughout the country? The elections, you know, they're on before the elections for months, they're on.
You talking about our signs?
Any signs, any political signs that are all over the property, all over the county, for extended periods of time, well, to the point that they utterly become trash.
Well, they do, and signs on private property, meaning if I came to you and asked you if I could put a sign in your yard, that's probably not what you're talking about.
I think I've truck going down the road with 46 signs just sticking them everywhere.
If I have signs out there that are in the right-of-way,
yes,
they need to pull them, number one.
Yeah.
If they are there, you know, there are a lot of people that get involved in a project, and then if they win or lose, they forget about it, don't you say?
Okay.
Well, I think it's legal. I don't agree with it at all. And if I'm a candidate, I need to be responsible to make sure my signs are up. What I did is I paid the Boy Scouts in this county $1 per sign for everyone they brought. And I'm going to tell you what, they went out there like gangbusters. There wasn't a sign read.
Okay. So how can we get everybody to do what you did?
Well, those are people like me.
That's not enough.
Any other questions? I don't know that. I don't know that. Do we have ordinances against it? I guess we can take them. It's about the best we can do. I don't know any other answer. Just, hopefully people will be responsible and get their signs. Yes,
Patrick, I know that you recused yourself from this, and I'm not, it's nothing to do with this. It's just about United Community Bank, and it's just a concern. Because, I mean, I am a shareholder of United Community Bank as well, and I have sat and I have watched in the last 2.5 years them go from $38 a share.
62 cents.
No, today it was 706, I believe.
Oh, okay.
But in June, they had a reverse split,
5-1.
Which takes one share, I mean 5 shares, and puts it all in one to inflate the one share to make it to where they are not, to make it to where they're not below $2, to where they have market issues. We've taken and we took on that contract with them. If it was I've been out of the loop a little bit. I don't know if there's a contract with them, but the concern is, and I realize that there is a municipality that would have to be insured from, because it is a state revenue issue, at 110%. But what happens when we get to the point where it's reporting to the state, because the United Community just keeps falling. And it went, like I said, from $38, then they had a reverse split to go back to make it in June to where it looked so bad. Now we're down to $7.06. The COO retired in September, which is one from the old Rawls Bank that would have never, I couldn't imagine him retiring, you know? I mean, my concern is our capital
our
money. You say that, but what happens when Habersham County is in there, Union County is in there? I think we've got 5 or 6 more municipalities that I found out about today. So wait a minute, let me talk, let me finish, okay?
Yep.
We've got all that. But they report to the state board every month to make sure, to state revenue, and state revenue makes sure it keeps them in check. But what happens when that month that they actually have another loss, like they did this last quarter, who's going to be left holding that? Because FDIC is not going to pick up that 110%.
And it's not going to come out of their, it's not going to come out of their revenue or their capital either, because they're not going to have it.
They had to purchase treasury notes equal to 110% of our deposit.
I understand that, but we need, as I was explaining to you today, okay, because it was a concern of mine, just because that's what keeps our bond rating. That's what keeps us there.
And is our money safe?
And that's right. And they continue to lose. They may have had to purchase bonds, but what happens to that point when they start hitting that wall? Are y'all going to move out of the bank?
Well,
are you going to make that decision? Because we're about there.
You know, the bank contract's renewable every year, even though it's a long-term contract. It still has to be approved every year.
If we're not within that year, and it hits it every month.
I'm comfortable that our cash is safe, if that's what you're asking.
So when they get down to...
They can't touch the treasury bonds.
When they get down...
Then we move.
And then, okay.
If they can't provide the services that we need and they're unsafe, then we move it. I mean, there's no reason that, I know that people like to cook up these grand schemes.
No, that's not what this is about, and don't start.
No, but the reality is...
But I'm just trying to ask, I'm just asking the question, because it is a question, because that is all that the county has.
You're right, and I'm comfortable that it's safe.
And they are a very small bank.
But if there is any indication that it's not going to be safe, of course we're going to move it. Of course we're going to move it.
Are you aware of how much they've gone down since y'all went through that?
I get reports all the time. I get reports from Wells. I get them from United Community Bank. I get them from SunTrust. Now, do I study them and memorize them? No, but I do watch them. The other thing is there's a big concern about why did we go with a bank that's charging us $50,000 a year from a bank that was going to do it for free. Okay, that $50,000 number was incorrect in the beginning. It was 30 to 50. Okay, that was 30 to 50. They've already saved us 40 grand. Credit card costs. So we've made $10,000 so far over and above.
How did they save on the credit card costs? Is it from the percentage of the credit cards that the water takes in?
They charge us less than SunTrust would have charged, and they charge us less than Bank of America. So the net result is going to be not free, a profit to the county at the end of the year. And that report's being provided now because we've got some months behind us now to be able to look at that. We don't have a full year. But the fact of the matter is we're going to actually make more money than we would have with Bank of America, which was hosing us, and SunTrust with their free service. It wasn't free. You know, that the facts will be there.
It's a question, and it's a very big concern.
I know you're concerned about it. I've seen it. And if you think that I'm willy-nilly not worried about it, yeah, I do watch it. Absolutely. But I'm one of five commissioners, and we all do that, and we have a finance committee, and we have staff, and we all...
I'm asking a question, and I know there's five, and please don't be that way, because I'm just asking a question out of concern, okay?
Well, it's safe.
Okay.
It's totally safe.
Patrick, you may have already answered this question, but is every dollar we have with United Community Bank FDIC insured?
No. It's not eligible for FDIC insurance because it's too great.
Okay, have you ever heard of CDARS, C-D-A-R-S?
I have. No.
You have never heard of CDARS?
No.
Okay, CDARS is a program for municipalities or for an individual who just sold a business, say they sold a business for $20 million, or say the municipality has $200 million. CDARS, and I know SunTrust, does sell CDARS. So does all the big banks do. But what it does, it splits that money up, and you don't have to do a thing. The bank does it for you to enough banks so that everything is covered FDIC insured. Now, why doesn't our county have that money in a bank or some institution that will have CDARS for them so that every penny we have will be FDIC insured?
Well, Mr. Ward,
Mark Howard talks about this all the time.
If the money's lost, you don't get an equestrian facility. That's just the way it
is.
I hope you want to protect AIG that money for your horses.
The many companies are protected, but there's nothing like FDIC.
You need to get on one.
It's going to be good unless the federal government fails.
I guess my question led to, we saw the Integrity Bank crash. Everybody felt it. That's why we have a lot of these mothball subdivisions.
I'd say a lot of banks had problems.
Well, but I'm saying that is it.
I wouldn't say it's Integrity. I'd say it's a lot of banks.
Integrity, Bank of North Georgia, your big developer lender banks, United Community Bank, Community Bank and Trust.
Those are the four biggest developer lending banks in Georgia, okay? With that, they're the four most declining in stock prices and losses as well. Why did we not pick some, like a bigger bank that we actually could be safe with to not to have to sit and babysit?
We're totally safe with United Community Bank. Totally safe. 110% totally and unequivocally safe.
Did you find that out this morning?
I've known it all along.
Okay. I'm just asking the question.
I've known it all along. They had to capitalize everything we put in the bank. Every dollar we put in, they put $1.10 aside. And they have to.
Well, actually, they put $1.17, but that's, neither here nor there.
Totally safe. I have no problem. And I'd rather help a Georgia bank recover than I would any other bank out of the country. Mm-hmm. SunTrust is a pretty good bank, but
the point is, they're plummeting. So are we going to let Forsyth County go down with them?
We're not going anywhere.
Have you seen their Texas rating?
If they fail, we just move our money to another institution. Our money's safe.
But if they fail, you're saying we're safe, but if they fail.
Yeah.
If they fail, we're safe.
So
we're safe.
Is there something we can look up to find that information out? Just where would we go to find that?
Well, you can go back and watch the work session and watch the presentations on what was done. You could go pull the banking contract. You could ask for a copy.
Where do we get the banking contract?
Call the finance department. Do an open records request and ask for the contract.
And
ask
it will give us the proof of what you're saying we're safe.
You'll see it in the contract. Do you think I was saying if it wasn't true?
Well,
come on now.
Frankly.
What bank are we talking about?
United Community.
United Community?
Yes.
Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah, Joe asked about science. My question is, who paid for the vote for the SPLOST signs? Where did that come from? Who paid for those vote yes for SPLOST?
It was a committee formed. I have no idea, though.
Did it come from tax money?
No.
The government money? I mean, was it just people who put it out of their own pocket?
There's a committee formed called
Citizens for Progress.
Citizens for Progress.
Yeah. So the Chamber of Commerce.
It was put together by the Chamber of Commerce, and they went out and got donations.
They raised about $38,000.
And my other question is, there's going to be an equestrian park. Can I have an ATV park?
Yeah. Well, it's funny you say that. I've been trying to find a way to get to use the old landfill on Old Federal for a BMX or ATV park. But we've not been able to get clearance yet from to use the old landfill. So, yeah, I'm working on it.
Well, trails up the mountain would be nice, too.
You better talk to Mary Helen DeBruder about that. If you get her to approve it, I'm on board.
We have got a 7,000 there.
No, but there's one in Dawson.
We used to have one.
Yes,
ma'am. Hurt Bridge.
I think there was a question on delivery service.
I'm sorry?
Delivery service on Sandation. She talked about the water and the loss.
Did you have another question about it?
It was one of the things that's coming up, the delivery service for
service delivery strategy and loss. Yes, ma'am.
But did we talk about the service delivery? I missed it if we did.
Well, it's a part of the negotiation process. Loss and service delivery kind of go hand in hand.
Oh, do they?
Because you have to decide what services each jurisdiction is going to pay for, so then you can use that as part of the equation in determining the split. So.
Has the mayor ever considered giving up his police department and it being just a county sheriff? It seems like you were talking about a redundancy in service. That appears to be, especially with a new jail going to be located in the city.
Well, it could be, and I would say that that's certainly his decision to do. One of the things that we have to recognize is the recreation department through the city, the police department through the city. What else? That's probably all the optional services. You know, that services they have elected to provide over and above.
They have their own garbage too, don't they?
They do, but it's privatized. So they don't want it themselves. you know, the reality is our sheriff's office has jurisdiction from border to border to border, but we have an intergovernmental agreement to where the city provides most of the law enforcement within the city boundaries. But if Forsyth mayor were to get rid of it, we're obligated to provide law enforcement anyway as part of the part of
our. I just thought that might be something you could negotiate.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Commissioner Bell, for having us out this evening. The local option sales tax, or LOST, currently the city gets 15%. It's established, as I understand it, to roll back our property taxes if you're a landowner or a property owner in the county. So as a result of the split right now at 15%, the city seems to have an incredible amount. In fact, the first check that the city received back in the early 90s was more than two times their previous year's total expenditures. My point is that if we are able to reduce the amount that the city gets, let's just guess down to maybe 3%, that savings to the county for each and everybody who's a property owner in here for an average home would be about $300 a year. Over a 10-year taxation is $3,000 out of your pockets to continue to operate these other facilities and things we're talking about. The idea is that we need to equate and balance the schedule a little bit between the city and the county. Oftentimes, if you look at other municipalities, it almost always follows with the population, almost always. And that's statistically proven, but that's not the way you make the determination. The services are what that is determined by. So you've committed, as I heard you say earlier, that you're going to work to negotiate the lowest rate we can, because obviously, if you don't, the higher the rate is to the city, the more we will pay as property tax owners, as owners with more property tax will pay.
Well, correct. I didn't say the lowest. I said the fairest and the best for all involved. I look at every situation not as an S and M, but what is a win-win for both involved.
So how do you justify me paying $300 more in taxes and allowing the city of Cumming to have it? Because that's where it is about right now. I could use the $300 a year, the $3,000 over a 10-year period. There's a lot that wants to be done in this room. That's a boatload of money that we're allowing the mayor to have. You wonder why all their buildings are paid for? You know, why they don't have property taxes? Why their streets are, you know, the way they are, and why the county's suffering?
Lost. I can assure you that when I do this year, it will be the fairest that I can come up with.
What would be a starting point?
No, I don't think 3% is going to be there. I don't think that's going to make it at all. Do I think it's going to be 15%? No, that's way too much. So we have to look at the services provided, look at the cost, look at the two budgets, look at the value of the digest and the county-wide, including the city, because we are everybody, and work for those negotiations. Now, I will also tell you that I'm not the chief negotiator of LOST. I will have part of it. I will tell you that I'm being hired by other counties to help negotiate their loss. So I do have a pretty good bit of experience in it. I've got three counties I'm working with. Or hope to have contracts this week. So I've put a lot into studying loss and service delivery strategy from both the city side and the county side. And when you look at their training, it's tit for tat all the way down. They've both done a good job of figuring out how to bust the other one's argument up.
With the argument that you have there, for instance, Cobb County, they have multiple municipalities. They don't have this fight over loss. They generally have it figured out fairly decently, and it continues on. Because we have only one other municipality in Forsyth County, it's been referred to as before the big dog and the little dog. And everything that I'm hearing here screams for consolidation of the city and county. So every citizen of the city and of the county is equally represented, and we're all taxed the exact same way. The city of Cumming and the few folks who live in the city of Cumming, they have benefits because you and the county give it to them.
I don't support consolidation. I believe that the city does a good job. I think they serve a purpose. As far as the big dog, little dog, previous negotiations, had nothing to do with those, so I can't even begin to discuss what was done at that time, what negotiations were, what thought process went into it. I have no clue. What I can tell you is, in the upcoming negotiations, I will work to negotiate the very best rate I can, the most fairest rate for the taxpayers, because whether they live in the city or not, they're all county taxpayers.
Would you commit, after you agreed to a percentage or number, would you commit to an explanation letter to the citizens of the county to explain to them, here's why we agreed on, let's say, 12.5%, because that's what's being rumored and batted around, that it's already been decided that it's going to be 12.5%. And I'm like, my goodness, that's an extra, you know, $2,500 over 10 years out of everybody's pocket in here as a homeowner.
I don't issue a letter of explanation, but I will tell you that all of our meetings are open. The work sessions are open where all those negotiations take place. We will have public hearings on them. We're all accessible. So we're there.
Thank you. Hey, one follow-up question. You also had a commitment and attempted to pass a resolution. It didn't pass, but it was talking about fiscal responsibility, that you Absolutely. Wanted to make sure that the SPLOST money was going to be spent in the most prudent fashion. One particular area that I'm familiar with on the SPLOST is Castleberry Road. It's planned for a four-lane road. You look at that and you're like, you got to be kidding me. Is there anything you can offer, maybe a commitment that you could offer so that that would remain a two-lane road? Because that's available in prudent spending, after all, would save for a road that arguably now has different data for travel, that it's antiquated for what is currently happening today, meaning that Castleberry Road doesn't have the traffic that it did at one time because of other road improvements. And so the idea is, can Castleberry Road stay as a two-lane road?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Do I think it will? I don't know. I've committed to Commissioner Levent that if we can get traffic studies done by reputable companies, that I'd be willing to look at a two-lane parkway with adequate turn lanes, adequate stacking, adequate safety, adequate lighting, et cetera. I'd be happy to look at that.
Thank you.
One thing that people and I'm not suggesting it's you, but a lot of people criticize me because they think I stand on a certain position, but yet they never asked me like you just did. And I will tell you, Brent, I'm open-minded until I push the button. Nothing is decided until I push the button. So, yes, I'm okay with that. The animal shelter is going forward. We got a meeting next week. It'll be on the next work session. It's going to have an update on that. That's a project that I wanted to see go forward, but I wanted to see go forward in a responsible manner and not just thrown out quickly before somebody went out of office. I've been committed to the animal shelter since day one, but nobody's asked. So I'm glad you asked that question because it allows me to, you know, maybe clarify what people think they think I'm thinking. Thanks, Brad. But yes, I am. I've already talked to Commissioner Levent. That's why I'm not considering.
I don't live in that district, by the way, I don't have a dog in the fight. I'm just aware of certain situations like that that exist around the county, and it's like, please, before we think we have to spend this money because it showed up on the list, let's apply a little bit of reasonability to some of those expenditures.
You're absolutely right. Anybody else? No?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Here's the thing. I know the location.
They have no idea.
Yeah, amazing what a kid
she is. Doesn't want me to have
it. Amazing what a kid is. Keep your eyes on my way.
I'm sure they did. I didn't plug down.